1 John chapter 3, and we're going to go ahead and read verses 1 through 10. Lord, we need your help this morning, Lord, with your precious word. Pray that you speak your truth, Lord God. We love your word this morning. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Now, the first verse, I got to tell you, don't get tricked on me here, because like I always talk to y'all about this verse, but I really just wanted to go back to the beginning of the chapter and read through verse 10. That's not the verse that I really wanted to focus on, but it's part of the whole text. Amen. It says, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure." And so really in the first part of this passage that we just read, I've explained this to you many times before, but that word manner there is literally means another tribe, nation. Essentially, what John's talking about is a foreign place. Amen? And what he's talking about is that the love of God comes from a foreign place. It's foreign to our mindsets. It's foreign to our hearts. It's foreign to the internal nature that we have, that we received in our first birth from Adam. God's love is altogether different and beyond our comprehension. Even whenever we love someone, many times our motives are impure in our love towards that person. But God's motives are never impure. God's motives are always pure. They're without sin, amen, because he's holy. Now, what he's saying is that the love that God has bestowed, this love that came from this other realm, has done this miraculous, beautiful work. And what it's done is it's turned you and I into, if we truly are believers, the sons of God. And that's what the Apostle John is really, for lack of better words, blown away by. That's what's taking him into consideration and thinking about this love that comes from this foreign realm, because he's become a born-again son of God. And because of that, the world doesn't know him. See, the world doesn't recognize the true child of God or understand or comprehend the true child of God, because they're caught in the midst of a trap. They're caught in a trap where they were born like their father Adam, right? But they've never been born again. You know, it wasn't that long ago that I was going to the jail. I would do street ministry, you know, still do some street ministry. But one of the things that I would tell people sometimes, I can remember saying it on multiple occasions, is that, you know, because they would look at me sometimes and they would think, I don't have anything in common with this guy. You know, and I could sense it whenever I was talking to them. And I would say, we might not have a whole lot in common, but we got this one thing in common. We were both born of Adam. We were both born of Adam. We were both born in sin. The thing that we don't have in common is that you just haven't been born again. But that's okay, because that can happen today. Amen. You can be born again today. You can become a born again son of God. The life of God can come into the inside of you. Amen. And you can be released from the trap that's been set for you whenever you were born in Adam. You've been ensnared. You've been placed into captivity and bondage in your first birth of Adam. And so it looks completely different than the world. They're not used to that. And he goes on to talk about the fact that we don't know exactly what it all means, but we do know that one day we're going to see him. And when we see him, we're going to be as he is. And he goes on to talk about the fact that we're going to be like him. And so whenever we have that hope on the inside of us, knowing that this love, this word from a foreign realm has come down here and produced a new birth in us, and we've become the sons of God. And while we don't really know exactly what all that means, right, in the here and now, we know that one day we're going to be like him. And when we know that, it does something on the inside of us. And it says right here that whenever you have that hope in you, you purifieth yourself, because even he is pure. Now that word purifieth, we've talked about this word so many times. It comes from this root right here, hagiazo, which is a word that's translated as sanctified. And literally, again, it's meaning, you know, I tell you this all the time, the Bible's saying the same thing over and over again, really. When you get down to the bottom of it, when you get down to the root, it's saying the same thing again and again, to be set apart, to be made holy. Amen. And so really, once again, the word can be translated as sanctified. It's the set apart ones. You've been the chosen out ones, the set apart ones. And we need to understand that we're a partaker in this process with God, knowing that He has provided a plan and knowing that He also desires for us to move and operate with Him in the midst of this plan through faith. Amen.
Amen.
He goes on to say right here, whosoever committeth sin transgresseth. Transgresseth also the law. The word transgresseth describes a walking outside of or a wandering. So whenever we transgress God, when we transgress His boundaries, when we transgress His law, we're wandering off the beaten path. You know, many times I'm just thinking of this as I say the word path. The Lord, I believe, dropped it in my spirit that Jesus is known as the way. John the Baptist came to prepare a way for the way. The word way is hadas. It's an easily discernible path. I know I've used this analogy before, but whenever we were young boys, or at least when I used to play around in the woods, I'm not much of a hunter, but I used to hang out in the woods when I was a kid. So every now and then you'd light upon a path. You could tell somebody had been walking in a particular direction. The path was, it was easily discernible. There could be weeds growing over, trees all over the place. But you found this path and you said, that leads to somewhere. Amen. When Jesus came upon the earth, the path had been obscured. The path had been, it wasn't easy to see. It wasn't easily discernible. But John the Baptist came to prepare a way. He said, repent. Repent and get your heart right so that you can see the path and you can get on the path. Amen. And that's what Jesus is. He's an easily discernible, clear path to God the Father. Amen. And what you and I need to know, though, is that whenever we begin to wander off the path, then now there's danger that lurks ahead.
Yes.
There's traps that are set in the woods. Once again, I'm not a hunter and I'm not a trapper, but I know they got some traps out there. As a matter of fact, as I'm thinking about it, you get off of the paths and somebody been setting some traps out there. There's a possibility without you realizing it, you could get your foot stuck in a coon trap or get your foot stuck in something that you didn't plan on getting stuck in. Amen. He says, but what he's talking about right here, he's talking about the law specifically. Now, the reason that John is talking about the law is because there was an early heresy. I'm just trying to give you a little bit of context right now regarding this passage of Scripture. There was an early heresy that entered into the church, and it was called Gnosticism. And Gnosticism believed that the body was separate from the spirit, and that the body was inherently evil, and really and truly, it didn't matter what you did with the body, it was the spirit that was born again. So essentially, you could live Mardi Gras every day and still say you were saved. And what true Christianity says is that, no, that's not the truth. That whenever true Christianity takes place in the heart, it begins to deal with the inner man, amen, and it begins to cause a change to take place on the outside of the life also. And so, therefore, there is the desire to stay on the path.
Amen.
And not to venture off of the path where the traps lie. Amen?
Amen.
He says, also the law, for sin is the transgression of the law. And you know that He was manifested to take away our sins. And in Him is no sin. Whoever abideth in Him sinneth not. Whosoever sinneth hath not seen Him, neither known Him. Well, we need to take a little bit of a second with this and try to talk about this for a moment. First of all, the idea of manifested means to be declared, to be brought forth, to be made visible. What the author is saying, what the Holy Spirit is saying through Him is that this is the very reason that Jesus was made clearly discernible. This is the very reason that John the Baptist was the forerunner that was sent to say, hey, repent, prepare your heart, for the King has finally come. This is the very reason that God from the beginning of time would tell us through Peter, you were not redeemed with the corruptible things such as silver or gold, but by the precious blood of the Lamb, which was foreordained before the foundation of the earth. God knew that He had a plan of a pathway that would lead us to righteousness, a pathway that would lead us to victory, a pathway that would lead us to liberty. This is why He was manifested. Why? To take away our sins.
Yeah.
And once again, now, what we've got to understand, though, is He goes on to say this, in Him is no sin. And we've talked about this, but the sinless one died in place of the sinful ones. Amen? And He had no sin. He was pure. He was the obedient one. And then the question is this, and the statement is that whoever abides in Him sins not. The word abide means to live in a place. Where do you live? You know, you dwell in a particular place. When you're within the walls of your home, you're in a certain sphere. You could say that when you're dwelling in Christ, you're on the path. You can say that when you're living in Him, you're in the right spot. You're walking with Him. You're dwelling with Him. You're in Christ. Amen? But then the word sin goes on to say, when it says sinneth not, it's not talking about one act of sin. It's talking about a habitual lifestyle. A habitual lifestyle of chronic sin that goes on and on and on, and there's no conviction connected to it. There's no desire really to get your life right with God. He's trying to talk to these heretics. He's trying to talk to these Gnostics, and he's trying to explain to the church that what they're saying is not true. You cannot continue to live a chronic lifestyle of sin and call yourself a child of God. The reality of it is that is contrary to the truth of God's word. That's not what God's plan does. God's plan moves on the inside of the heart and begins to change things, amen, and begins to redirect us from the wandering off the path back onto the path.
Yes.
He said, whoever abideth in Him, who lives in Him, who dwells in Him, does not live a chronic life of sin. But whoever sinneth or lives a chronic life of sin has not seen Him, neither has he known Him. Mm. Whenever you see people, they can say one thing.
Amen.
But whenever they're continuing to live another way, the reality of it is that we have to question, do they really, really know the Lord?
Yes.
He goes on to say, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous, even as he is righteous. The word doeth describes actions. It describes what comes out of the person, what you see on the outside. Because once again, we talked about the fact that true Christianity does something on the inside, but at the same time, the righteous acts begin to come out of them also, because Jesus was the righteous one. Amen. Jesus was the righteous one, and He did righteous things. And so when Jesus lives in your heart, and you, when He lives in you and you live in Him, what happens is that righteous acts begin to come out of you. Amen. Even as He is righteous, he that committeth sin is of the devil. Not now of the devil, coming out from him. Really, you could say born of him, a son of him. Versus a son of God. That's what the whole context of the passage is. The first time born of Adam, born in sin, and that's what the devil did. He was the first sinner. The enemy of our soul was the first sinner, the first one that transgressed the law of God. Was there a Ten Commandment stones? No, that was before that. But he knew what God was, he knew who God was, and he rebelled against God. He didn't want to be a servant to God, he wanted to elevate himself above God. God had a certain order in the system, and the liar saw that order and rebelled against it, transgressed the boundaries, went off the path, went outside. He's the one that initially initiated sin. He brought sin into the world, and now all he knows to do is sin, and he sinned from the beginning, from the time that he fell, and the idea in the Greek language is that he continues that pathway ever since then. He never stops. Everything that he does is sin, and he continues down the pathway of sin. For the devil sinneth from the beginning, and for this purpose, once again, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil.
Yes.
Not just that he would take away our sins, lift them up off of us. That's what the idea in the first passage that we read, that he would lift them up off of us. That's what he did. He bore our infirmities, amen. He bore upon himself. He took it off of humanity and he brought it upon himself. Not that he would just take it away, but that also, hallelujah, he would destroy the works of the devil.
Hallelujah.
He had to become us, so that he could die for us, so that he could destroy the works of the enemy, the trap, the snare that had been laid, that he could destroy the power of the evil one who held sway over us. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, does not continue to live a chronic lifestyle of sin. Why? For his seed remaineth in him. And he cannot sin because he is born of God. When you get born again and the Holy Spirit comes to live on the inside of you, and the seed of God lives on the inside of you, the Holy Spirit's dealing with you, he's ministering to you, he's speaking to you, he's having a discussion with you.
Amen.
He's talking to you. And the question that you and I have to ask ourselves is, are we listening?
Yes.
Are we listening to the God of glory when he speaks to us? In this, the children of God are manifest. Oh, that's good. We had two words earlier where God, Jesus was manifest. He was declared. He was made visible. He was brought forth. Why? So that he could take away the sin that laid upon you and I, so that he could destroy the works of the devil. And when you and I begin to emulate the behavior of our Savior, what are you talking about, preacher? When you and I begin to act like him through the power of him that lives in us and dwells in us, now the children of God are made visible. Now the children of God are made clear. Amen. Yeah. Through their actions. Yeah. Through the fact that they're walking on the pathway. Through the fact that they're not wandering off. Amen. And the children of the devil. You get to be able to see both. It becomes real clear. People can call themselves a Christian. Sadly, you know, I don't say that in a judgmental way. A lot of people think that they are Christians just because their mom and their daddy were a Christian. And that's why if you Google right now, while we're sitting here talking, the recent Gallup poll or whatever, how many Christians are there in America? The number runs somewhere around 80-85% of people say that they're Christians, but they don't really know what it means. You understand what I'm saying? They were just told that they were a Christian. They were told that they believed in Jesus, but they've never really given their life or their heart to the Lord. Whenever you get born again, when you give your heart to Jesus, something happens miraculously on the inside. The Holy Spirit comes to live in your heart. He keeps you on a path, amen, amen. To move in the right direction. We already talked about the fact that there was an early heresy in the early church known as Gnosticism, and we talked about the fact that true Christianity contradicts what they thought. Like, you can't just live Mardi Gras every day and call yourself a Christian. The reality of it is that God desires to change you not only on the inside, but also that your actions would also be changed on the outside. Amen? Amen. But the first point that I wanted to talk about was having to do, well, first of all, the title of my message this morning is called Catch and Release. Kind of like, you know, you catch a fish and then you release it. But the reality of it is that I think the way I was thinking of it more is that when you catch a fish, you have him snared. And then all of a sudden, you know, not that the fish has a brain to think that well, but when he's released, he's set free. The reality of it is that humanity, all of us at some point in time have been ensnared. But we also need to understand that God is the one Amen. Who is able to release us. Amen. My first point that I wanted to talk to you about has to do with the natural versus the spiritual. Amen. And I wanted to just talk about the fact that our Father in heaven, he gave us the first and the last Adam as fathers of our births. What I mean by that is that in our first birth in Adam, we received from him a physical birth. Adam was a physical creation, if you will, that was formed from the physical earth. And he is the father of our first birth. And when we're born the first time like Adam, we're born like him. We're born sensual. We're born sinful because when we came forth from Adam, the fall had already taken place. And so in the first birth, we're like him. And in that birth, we receive a sinful nature from him because in our natural birth, we are born once again from his fallen state. It's important that we understand this, that this is where Satan sets his sights when he plans his attack. He attacks that part of the person. He attacks that fallen nature, that thing where sin indwells on the inside of. See, the flesh truly is neutral. The flesh, this physical body that we live in, it's not like what the Gnostic heretic said, that the flesh was inherently evil. No, the flesh is just a neutral member. And it goes whichever way we allow it to go. And so what we need to understand is that the enemy of our soul, he plans his attack at that fallen aspect of man, that fallen fleshly part that is corrupted by sin. Temptation entices our fleshly desires to seek pleasure outside of God's will. Just as Adam and Eve sought knowledge outside the boundaries of God, just as the enemy, he transgressed God and went beyond his boundaries, the same happens to us, and he will focus his attack on our fallen nature and try to make us rebel against God's will. In James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15, James talked about temptation. He said, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation." See, you can expect that temptation's coming your way. You can expect that the enemy of your soul is going to try to entice your flesh to go outside of the path, to go outside of the boundaries that God has set for you. But the man that endureth the temptation, when he's tried, when he's put to the test, he shall receive the crown of life which the Lord hath promised to them that love him. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempts he any man. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust. You see that word drawn right there? Lured out as in hunting. The bait of the trap. The snare. I remembered it this morning when I looked at that word. The snare of the fowler. Back in Psalm 91:3, he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler. The fowler was a bird trapper. He'd set a snare for the bird and he put bait along it. See, if the bird just stay where he's supposed to stay and not venture over there to the bait, then what would end up happening is that he would get snared by the fowler's trap. And this is what happens, is that we're drawn away. We're drawn away off the path, the place where we're supposed to abide, the place in Christ, whenever the enemy begins to attempt. But it's already in you. It's in us.
Amen.
That fallen nature that we received in our physical birth from Adam, and we're drawn away of the own lust that's within us. And we're enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin. It gives birth to sin. It's been given birth to us, and it grabs a hold of us. And ultimately, when sin does that, it causes death spiritually on the inside of our lives. And ultimately, if it's left unchecked, it can result in physical death. But in our second birth in Jesus, because remember, we're talking about the natural versus the spiritual. In our first birth in Adam is the natural birth, the physical birth, that which is born like him with a sinful nature. But God's so beautiful, he gave us two fathers to be born after. And in our second birth, hallelujah, it's the last Adam. And in our second birth in Jesus, we're born again spiritually. The life of God comes to live in us, and we become partakers of the nature of God. I want you to put 2 Peter 1:4 up there. If you have your Bibles, you can turn there. He says, this is what Peter says about it. He says, whereby are given unto us exceeding great and precious promises, that by these you might be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. You see, the corruption that's in the world. The corruption describes the decay. It describes the result of what's going to happen of those born of Adam, those that refuse to go God's way. You and I have been given an escape route. Just as we've been talking about being snared, God gave us an escape route to flee from, to be able to escape. And you and I have become partakers. You know what's interesting is that I keep talking about these words in the Greek, and I had to look it up because I had a feeling. And I've been talking to y'all about this word, koinonia. And the word is translated many times as communion. And it means joint participation with. And this word in the Greek is from that root, and it means to be a partner with. And so in our new birth in Christ, in our first birth in Adam, we received a sinful nature. And we had a desire to go to where we were trapped into going towards that which is not of the Lord, to venture off the path. But in our new birth, in our spiritual birth in Christ, we've become a partner with him, and now we can share in his divine nature because the Holy Spirit lives on the inside of us. So now while Satan is attempting to stimulate our fallen nature to rebel against God, the Holy Spirit in us and the nature of God that we are now connected to is screaming something else. While Satan is trying to make us rebel, the Holy Spirit speaking and pleading, amen, and talking to us to go another way. And in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 45 through 48, it basically talks about the spiritual versus the natural. It says, and so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. 1 Corinthians 15, 45 through 48. The first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam, talking about Jesus, was made a quickening spirit. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. In other words, he's saying the first one was Adam, and that wasn't spiritual. That was natural, physical, of the earth, a physical creation, and which is perishing. Because really what Paul's talking about right here is the resurrected body.
the glorified body, eternal life. And he's talking about the fact that the first one was born natural, which is decaying and is corrupt of this earth, but that the second one was the spiritual one. And there's a first birth and there's a second birth. And the first birth leads to being trapped and leads to corruption and decay, and the second birth leads to life, eternal. But not only upon this earth, but yes, eternal life with a new glorified physical body. Amen. But at the same time today, a spiritual life. Amen. That's opposite and different than the natural life that we received in our first birth. As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy, and as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. God illustrated these first births of the natural, the fallen nature, and the spiritual, and the new creation through the father of the faith, Abraham. Amen. So he gave us two fathers. He gave us Adam, where our first birth came from Adam, and then he gave us Jesus, where our spiritual birth came through him. But in Abraham, the father of the faith, y'all know we call him the father of the faith, amen, God illustrated the plan of salvation through Abraham, and he allowed him to have two sons. Amen. And the first birth, again, I know we preached something that mentioned some of this not that long ago. The first birth was Ishmael. The second birth was Isaac. Both of these, again, corresponding to the concept between the flesh versus the spirit. The Ishmael being what Abraham did in disobedience towards God's plan. Going out on his own. Venturing off the path that God had laid down to trust him at his word, to trust him at his promise. Taking matters into his own hand. He and Sarah planning a new way to do it. And what was the plan? Go into the bondwoman, Hagar. Well, who was Hagar? What is a bondwoman? She was an Egyptian maiden. A bondwoman means she was their slave or their servant is what she was. She was a woman of bondage. She was not a free woman. She was not on her own. And she and Abraham, in his disobedience, gave birth to a child that wasn't free. Gave birth to a child of slavery. Once again, off the path. Once again, ensnared. Once again, caught in a trap. Slavery, bondage, entrapment, not freedom and liberty, not walking in the right path that God has provided for mankind. And the natural son, Ishmael, like the first one, Adam, leading to bondage, leading to slavery. Two, while Abraham trusted in his flesh and produced Ishmael, he also trusted in the Lord's promise and saw the birth of Isaac. Amen? And when we finally stop trusting in our own wisdom and strength and surrender to the Lord, he's given the freedom by us to bring about his will for our own lives. Have you ever thought about that? We're supposed to be partnering with the Lord. Koinonia, partner. You know, I remember the first time that I heard, I was on the radio and I heard them talking about giving the Holy Spirit liberty to work in our hearts. And that was the first time I'd heard anything like that before. It was almost like my flesh wanted to rebel against what I was hearing. Because when I first heard, I'd never heard anything like this before. I've been sitting in church all my life, listening to preachers talk to me all my life. And in my mind, the way that I had been told that God was limitless. And it was almost like I heard the people on the radio, it's almost like they were limiting God. But what I began to realize is this, God has a plan. He's got a plan and he's got a path. And he's not going to deviate off of it. And one of the things that I realized after I started to shut my mouth and quit thinking that I had everything figured out and listen to the teacher, I began to learn something that no, I can transgress God's ways, I can transgress God's plan, I can transgress his path, and I can frustrate the grace of God in my life, and then I now therefore don't allow the liberty of the Holy Spirit liberty to work in my life and to do what it is, and I'm the one that's stopping it. It's not God, it's not that his plan doesn't work, it's me. I'm the one that's stopping it. I'm standing in the way and I'm preventing the Holy Spirit from doing what it is that he wants to do. He's like, oh, I got good things for you. I'm waiting.
Amen.
I got good things for you. I'm waiting. I'm waiting for you to surrender to my will. I'm waiting for you to allow me to have the liberty that I want to have in your life. But you continue to stand in the way of what it is that I desire to do. He goes on to say, what I put here was that God will happily bless the spiritual, but he will never bless the flesh. And if you'll turn to Genesis 21:12, see, because Abraham, who is the illustration of the natural versus the spiritual, he gave birth to Ishmael, and he don't want to let Ishmael go. Ishmael's close to him. Ishmael's precious to him. But God's not going to bless Ishmael. Ishmael represents your own plans, your own wisdom, what you desire, what you want that's contrary to the will of God, but it also represents you trying in your own strength to accomplish God's will for your life. It says in Genesis 21:12, God said unto Abraham, let it not be grievous in your sight because of the lad, talking about Ishmael, and because of the bondwoman, talking about Hagar, because in all that Sarah has said unto thee, what did she say unto him? They got to go. They can't live in my house. They got to go. The Spirit says they got to go. And hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall your seed be called. What does that mean? God's plan of redemption, God's plan of salvation, God's plan of victory and liberty wasn't going through Ishmael, no matter how bad Abraham wanted it to. God's plan of victory and liberty was going through Isaac. Amen. And God will bless the spiritual, but he will not bless the flesh. Amen. The natural versus the spiritual was point one. Point number two is bondage versus freedom. These two mothers that we just spoke of, the Apostle Paul through the Holy Spirit uses them to describe the two covenants of God. In Galatians chapter 4, the Apostle Paul explained that the two mothers of the two children that Abraham fathered represent the two covenants. I love this passage of Scripture, and I got to be honest with you, for the longest time, I really didn't understand it. I knew it was good. I'm talking about after I already had a lot of revelation about the Scripture. I knew it was good. I knew it meant something really good. To me, it's good anyway. I don't know if you'll like it, but it's the Word of God, so I hope you do. But as I began to actually understand it, it's just to me, I love it. It's like I want to talk about it. I want to think about it. I want to read it. I want to understand it even better. So let's go ahead and try to understand it a little bit. Galatians chapter 4, verse 19 through 31. And I say we try to break it down a little bit too. It says, my little children, of whom I travail in birth again until Christ be formed in you, I desire to be present with you now and to change my voice, for I stand in doubt of you. So right now, the language that he's using is that he's talking like he's a pregnant woman, that he's in travail, birth pains, and that what's happening is he's a pregnant woman trying to give birth to a child of God. What he means by that is that as he teaches them the truth of Christian doctrine and the Holy Spirit intermixing himself with the truth of the Word of God, that Jesus is being formed on the inside of all of these Christians that represent the babies that he's trying to bring forth. But it's like labor, it's laborious. There's pain that's being connected to his ministry. And the reason why is, here we go again. Why? Because those Judaizers. That's the context. The Judaizers coming in. It's always heresy of some sort. Either you can be over here and you can live any old way you want, or you got to be over here and you got to still live according to the law. And the reality of it is that no, the balance is that Jesus died to set us free from the bondage of trying to live by rules and regulations. He set us free from the bondage of an overpowering presence of sin that drives us in the wrong direction. Amen. But at the same time, when we understand the Word of God, the Holy Spirit will help us to stay on the right path. Amen. It says right here, and he says, my little children, I travail in birth again until Christ is formed in you. So these Judaizers, these heretics are coming in behind and saying, you have to add law. Without saying that, but that's what they're saying. You have to add law to your grace. You have to add rules and regulations to your Jesus. You have to add circumcision to your faith. And until you do that, you're not really going to be righteous in the eyes of God. And you can take that and you can do whatever you want with it. But I can sit here and list a whole bunch of stuff. And I'm not trying to bore you because I know that I've listed it before. But Christians are taught these very things. Not circumcision. But you got to read more if you want to be righteous in the eyes of God. How many times have you tried to make a rule for yourself to read at least three chapters a day, and then when you fall short, you feel guilty over it? No. You got to go to church more. Please come to church. You got to, but even if you stay home on a Wednesday or Sunday night, the preacher might not like it. If you're saved, you're saved, brother. You know, and the reality of it is that, hey, I'm the one that was called to preach, not you. I'm just kind of giving you some freedom. So if you don't show up tonight, I guess it's my own fault. Okay, but at the same time, just remember, the preacher's over here. He's still showing up. Even whenever you don't like what he's saying, he's still showing up. Amen. And so let's joint participate together. Amen. Struggle with me a little bit. Amen. All right. Praise God. And so, you know, he's saying these things, but you can't add to what Christ has done.
That's right. Amen.
And when you do that, you frustrate the grace of God. But what they were trying to do was they were trying to get them to add rules and regulations and law, performance, some type of faith in something else other than what Christ has done for us at the cross. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Christ liberated us when he died at the cross. He gave us a new birth. A new birth with a new nature. A new birth, a new nature, a new access to a new path where the Holy Spirit is dwelling on the inside of us and strengthening us to do the work of God. But whenever man teaches something contrary, he'll teach all kind of stuff. He'll teach you to put your faith in your positive confession.
Amen.
How much scripture you quote if you're struggling with something in your life. How much you praise the Lord. You raise two hands instead of one, you'll get that freedom you're looking for. You fast 3 days a week, you'll get that freedom you're looking for. And you're adding something that you do, your performance, that's called self-righteousness to it.
Yeah.
Paul knew the danger of it. He knew the heresy of it.
Yeah.
You can't put your faith in what you do.
Yeah.
You can't put your faith in your performance. You can't hunker down like Daddy used to say and say, hey boy, pull yourself up by the bootstraps and you got to get this done. It doesn't work that way in the spiritual realm. It's a real good thing for you to remember on Monday morning when you don't want to get up and go to work. Nobody wanted to get up this morning to go to work, but that's what we do. We're working folk and we get up and we go to work. That's a good thing to use that right there, but it's not going to do you much good whenever you're going in against the enemy of your soul.
That's right.
You ain't going to just hunker down and get her done.
Amen.
You're going to need the help of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Amen. Moving and operating in the midst of your life. And if you attempt to operate under another system, under the system of law, like these Judaizers were trying to get the Galatians to do, you're going to see yourself getting entrapped again.
Yeah.
You're going to see bondage instead of liberty. Self-will ain't going to get it done. Your willpower ain't going to get it done.
Yeah.
You need the presence of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
So he said right here, tell me you that desire to be under the law. So he's talking to him. He's like, so you let these, basically what he's saying, hopefully it's okay for me to paraphrase. You're going to allow these clowns, I'm using it in vernacular, because he actually told him, he called them, oh, foolish Galatians, which means stupid ones in the Greek. That's what it means, oh, stupid ones. Like, you're not reflecting, you're not thinking. I know that sounds harsh, but I didn't write it. The reality of it is many times as Christians, we don't stop and think. We just take whatever a man or a woman regurgitates, what they heard from their body, or they heard from some pyramid structure coming down, and they just feed us all this information, and we don't ever stop and think. He says right here, tell me you that desire to be under the law, do you not hear the law? For it is written that Abraham had two sons, the one by a bondmaid, the slave, the other by a free woman. But he who was of the bondwoman was born after the flesh, but he of the free woman was by promise. All right, so let's just stop for a second, and let's just talk about this, because I think for the longest time, I had a hard time understanding this. So Abraham, 2000 B.C., Abraham had two wives, but he had the bondwoman, Hagar, bondwoman, and he had Sarah, the free, right? And from Hagar, he had Ishmael. And from Sarah, he had Isaac, right?
Yeah.
And Isaac is the promised seed. And Ishmael is the bond, is the slave. He was born into slavery. All right? And so I wanted you to be aware of that, because he's gonna make a shift. He's gonna shift gears here in a second, and he's gonna bring us closer to the time frame of 1450 BC. and Moses and Mount Sinai. Okay? What happened at Mount Sinai? Do y'all remember? Does anybody remember what happened? A big event happened at Mount Sinai.
The burning. Well, God spoke to Moses.
God, yeah, but also what he gave us, where he gave him the law.
Right.
Gave him the law, right? So on Mount Sinai, God gave Moses the law. All right. So I want you to keep all this into because the next time you read Galatians, I hope that you'll understand it better. Because if you're anything like me, I didn't understand this passage of scripture for the longest time. I kept reading and reading it. All right, he says that they represent the two covenants. The two women that gave birth to the two sons represent the two covenants. The covenant of law, what he's saying is actually represented by Hagar. The old covenant, the first birth, Ishmael, was the bondwoman, gave birth to slave children. The second birth, Sarah, was the free woman, gave birth to Isaac, a free child that was born according to the promise. And he's saying they represent the two covenants. The old covenant, where the law was given, the new covenant, where Jesus was given. Isaac as a type of Christ, hallelujah, represents Jesus that brings freedom and liberty. Ishmael as a type of the law represents one that is born and lives in slavery and bondage. He says right here, he tells us, after was by promise, he says, which things are an allegory? For these are the two covenants, the one from Mount Sinai, which gendereth to bondage. Once again, we're talking about entrapment. We're talking about being trapped, which is Agar. It's another way to spell Hagar. For this Hagar is Mount Sinai in Arabia and answers to Jerusalem, which now is. So let's just slow down for a second. So he's completely shifted gears. I don't know about you, but if you ever read this before, he lost me right there. I'm like, well, Hagar lived over here in 2000 BC. Mount Sinai was over here in 1450 BC. How did you make this shit? He said, it's an allegory. Hagar was the bondwoman, and she represents the Old Testament law. Why? Because she was a slave, and the law results in slavery, results in bondage when you try to live according to it to bring forth righteousness in the midst of your life. And she represents the Old Covenant law, which was given on Mount Sinai, which the current Jerusalem, he was saying, is answering to. What does he mean by that? Because the Jews in Jerusalem were still trying to hold on to the temple worship and still trying to live according to the law, and now they were coming from Jerusalem into Galatia and telling them that they needed to live according to those rules and standards, and it was resulting in bondage instead of liberty and freedom. And so what the Apostle Paul was saying is that no, this is going to result in bondage and not freedom. And those that are living in Jerusalem that are trying to hold on to the law, and even some of them hold on to the law and Jesus at the same time, are in bondage to it, and now they're trying to bring that stuff over here and give it to you.
Yeah. Amen.
And that's what he said right there. He said that the one from Mount Sinai, which genders or gives birth to bondage, is Hagar. For this Hagar represents Mount Sinai in Arabia and answers to Jerusalem, which now is, and is in bondage with her children. Those inhabitants of Jerusalem at that time were in bondage because they were holding on to the law, which he was saying, this represents Hagar. But Jerusalem, which is above, is free. See, there's an earthly Jerusalem, and there was a spiritual Jerusalem. There was an earthly birth in Adam, and there's a spiritual birth in Christ. The first one was made a living soul. The second one was the Lord from heaven. There's a city called Jerusalem in heaven that Abraham was looking for, whose builder and maker was God. And from that place, like it said in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1, what manner of love is this? That's where that love came from. That other city came down to us, amen, and produced new life, new love, and produces freedom and liberty. And it's a promise that's given by God. Hallelujah. He says, Jerusalem, which is above, is free, which is the mother of us all, giving birth to new, the sons of God, going back to where we started. What manner of love is this that God has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God? God is giving birth, amen, to a new family of people that are born into freedom and not slavery. For it is written, rejoice, you that are barren and bear not. In other words, a woman whose womb is barren and can't have a child. Break forth and cry, you that travail not. For the desolate has many more children than she, which is a husband. The new covenant is going to produce more life. It's going to produce more children than the old covenant ever could. Now we, brethren, as Isaac was, are the children of promise. that as he then, he that was born after the flesh persecuted him that was born after the Spirit. Even so it is now. Nevertheless, what the Scripture says, cast out the bondwoman and her son, for the son of the bondwoman shall not be heir with the son of the free woman. So then, brethren, we are not the children of the bondwoman, but of the free. Amen. You can't live in both covenants at the same time. Can't live in the Old Testament and the New Testament at the same time. You can't live under laws and rules and regulations at the same time you're living under grace. You can't live in sin, chronic lifestyle of sin and righteousness at the same time. You can't live in your own strength and your own will and expect God to bless it. The bondwoman Hagar represents the law of the Old Testament, and the law was given rules and regulations and stipulations, but no power to accomplish God's will. Abraham's disobedience with Hagar produced a child of slavery, just like living a life of sin according to the flesh or trying to live for God according to the flesh in our own strength will do also. However, Abraham's trust in God with Sarah produced Isaac, who was a free child. And the grace of the New Testament corresponds to the Jerusalem above, meaning the city of God, from where His grace is given to empower His children that were born of the spiritual birth of Jesus, not remaining or staying in the first birth that we received from Adam. Amen? So there's a natural birth and there's a spiritual birth. And there's bondage and there's freedom. Amen? But there's also obedience versus disobedience. Yes. And that's where we started. In 1 John chapter 3, verses 7 through 9, those are the verses that I really wanted to concentrate on. He says, little children, let no man deceive you. He that doeth righteousness is righteous. He that his actions coming forth look like Jesus, why? Even as he is righteous. Talking about Jesus. He that committeth sin or lives a lifestyle of sin is of the devil, for the devil sinneth from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not commit sin, for his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin, for he is born of God. I love that word, destroy the works of the devil. That's one word in the Greek. It's luo, which in English is just, if you were to spell it in English, you would spell it like this, luo, and it means to loose. It's where we get our word, loose. So you were bound, you were in bondage, but the word here is that now you've been unbound, you've been released, you've been set free. Amen? That's what has been in the Greek text. That we talked about it earlier, about the committed sin, the chronic lifestyle of it, and there's no real desire to change. But we've already talked about the fact that when we're born again, something changes on the inside, and we become partakers of the divine nature. I read a story that kind of really tells what I'm trying to explain right now. There was this little girl. She was riding in the back seat with her daddy. She was in a car seat. I guess a booster seat, because she was old enough to talk and she was old enough to think. The girl just unbuckled herself and she stood up in the back seat. And she said, hey, daddy, I'm standing up on my seat. And he said to her with a firm voice, he said, young lady, you better sit back down in that chair and you need to buckle yourself back in that seat. And so she didn't really listen to him. Because, I mean, here's daddy driving, she's in the back seat, what's he really going to do? You know, some of these kids are pretty smart, they figure stuff out. He looks, he catches her eye in the rearview mirror and he puts that kind of like evil eye look on her. He says, girl, if I stop this car, I'm going to spank you. You need to sit down in that car seat and you need to buckle yourself back in there. With a little frown on her face, she plops herself back down in there and she buckles herself in. And he says, sweetheart, I'm very proud of you for listening to me, but you need to start working on listening to me the first time when I talk to you. But I am proud of you for doing the right thing. And so she's happy now. She's smiling. And, you know, they keep driving. He kind of looks at her a couple of times. And you can tell that she's kind of pondering or thinking about something. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, she says, daddy. And he says, yes, sweetie. She said, I'm still standing up on the inside. And you know, the idea there is this, is that here's our actions, but what we really need is for something to take place on the inside.
Amen.
We need God to do a work on the inside, amen? Because what our new birth in Christ has allowed us to become a joint participator with the Lord. And I don't know about you, but there's things in my life where I need God to do something on the inside, amen? To where I'll quit standing up on the inside. Amen? Because until he does that, I mean, I might get her done for a little while, but it's not, you're not going to pull yourself up by the bootstraps in this situation. Amen? So we should understand that this passage that we were talking about in 1 John 3 is not just talking about the actions of sin. Yes, that's the part that we see. But it's also talking about what's on the inside. And the fact that the natural versus the spiritual birth has taken place. Amen? And that we have now become partakers of the divine nature. In the natural birth of Adam, we receive a nature that is trapped in sin. Could you go ahead and come play? A natural birth of Adam, we receive a nature that is trapped in sin. In the new birth in Jesus, we become partakers of His nature. We are loose from the grip of sin and given liberty towards righteousness. When, like Abraham, we live our life the way we want or try to bring about God's plan for our lives through our own strength, we become a child of slavery like Ishmael. But when we, like Abraham, trust in the promise of God, we receive the power of grace from the heavenly Jerusalem and become children that are free. While it is true that all this means that we live in a spiritual battle and that the enemy desires to set a trap for our fleshly desires, it is also true that God gives us grace and strength to live righteous lives instead of a consistent life of sinning.